Rude Awakening.
And you are listening to Pacifica Radio, KPFA 94.1 FM. I'm Sabrina Jacobs, and this is A Rude Awakening. On today's show, I'll be speaking with Magdalena Rose Avila, a lifelong activist with many organizations, namely Amnesty International and the Cesar Chavez Foundation. He'll be discussing his latest battle for GMO labeling. Natalie Rizzi, mother and volunteer organizer with WORD. Women organized to resist and defend on their upcoming action to bring attention to Florida's Stand Your Ground case of Marissa Alexander. And Julio Escobar, director of the Restorative Justice Program of the Catholic Church, on the officer-involved shooting of Yanira Serrano in Half Moon Bay, whose funeral was this weekend. All that coming up next. Stay tuned. Magdalena Rose Avila is a lifelong human rights activist who grew up in Colorado. Mr. Avila is a poet, founding director of the Cesar Chavez Foundation, an Amnesty International affiliate, and founder of Homies Unidos, an organization that assists Salvadoran gang members transition to a better life. Leno has now taken on the GMO labeling campaign and will be here in the Bay Area at the end of this month. Leno, welcome to A Rude Awakening. Thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you very much.
All right. Now, let's start with why you are taking on this particular campaign for GMO labeling, the banning of GMO foods. Your resume is beyond impressive. What attracted you to this particular human rights issue?
Well, I had a break in employment, and it gave me a chance to think about what I really wanted to be involved in January.
Mm-hmm.
So I started doing some personal fundraising to cover my gas and food expenses. And I said, where is the next place where I can really take my historical experiences of human rights and put them to work? And I thought, you know, we have a chance to create history in Oregon, and in particular Jackson County. And people would ask me, well, why did you go? I said, there's no logical reason other than I think that America is on the edge of creating history and changing people's attitudes and movements about genetically modified organisms and seeds. And they did that in Jackson County. And I was so glad I was there to participate and help with them. And now I think we got a great chance to get labeling on the ballot and approved in November. So one of the things is that a lot of us who are dreamers, poets, or activists, you say, why do I want to get involved in that? Because the time is right. You have something to offer, and you ought to put your best energy and your best dreams to work in behalf of others.
So you are going to be here in the Bay Area. But before we start talking about your tour of the Bay Area, what happened in Jackson County? I know it was Jackson County, and then there was another neighboring county where there were some serious victories that were made as far as GMO labeling. Tell us about that.
Well, I think, you know, it's like all the movements about GMO seeds and GMO labeling where it's done by grassroots volunteers. In this case, it was done by our Family Farms Coalition. People go on the website. They can see everything, all the news clips, all the interest that was done there. And what really happened there is when Jackson County decided to put this issue on the ballot, Monsanto, Syngenta and the Farm Bureau went to the state legislature and they passed a bill that no other counties could do it. While the people in Josephine County, to the north of Jackson, which are all part of this rogue valley, they decided to have an election anyway and thumbed their noses at the state legislature. And they won by 58%, but the corporations didn't really spend money against them. In Jackson County, where it was a legal election and sanctioned by the state, they spent over $1 million and ran the most horrific ads against us. But what they did in Jackson County, because it was led by farmers, they had 170 farmers, 400 businesses, 150 medical personnel, is they ran a campaign that attracted Republicans, Democrats, older folks, younger folks, rich people, poor people. It was the biggest coalition I've ever been a part of. And I was able to be there to work with the Latino community, the Latino voters, student voters, and also to share some perspective of human rights movements for them. And I think, you know, in Jackson County, we beat these big corporations by 65.9%. That was our vote take. They have never been beaten that bad. They were shocked election night. They didn't know what to say or what to do. But what it is grassroots people building coalition and working together. And, you know, we had always talked in Jackson County long before the election that we were going to make history. And people should know, they should get onto this movement because they could become part of history. And people will remember who was there and who worked, just like the civil rights movement, just like United Farm Workers movement, just like the suffragette movement. It's a time to get on board, and now is the time for all of us to work together.
So this campaign that was ran, put into place, that won this vote at 69 or over 60%. Now, you said it went across the board. I mean, not to give up any strategy, but how did you guys do that? I mean, because go ahead.
Well, because, you know, when you looked at the vote totals, there were a lot more Republicans than Democrats, a lot more independents, Tea Partiers. And what we were saying, one of the big arguing issues is that, one, we don't want to poison the foods in that area. We want to maintain agriculture without, you know, cross-pollination by GMO seeds. And two is that we want to make protect the valley the way it was. It's a very small, beautiful valley. And people just, we decided that we were going to talk to everybody. And, you know, what was kind of freaky for me, because I've been on a lot of phone banks, and when you see a Republican 65, and in some cases as old as 84, coming up on your screen that you're going to call, you get a little hesitant. But once you call, 90% of them are saying, yeah, I'm with you. I don't want GMO in this valley. And that was the difference, is we talked to everybody. And we brought people in from all walks of life, and anybody who wanted to work, worked. And my job, you know, was not to be in the front or in the media, but was to work behind the scenes like so many of us, because we didn't want people to say outsiders came in and worked, because most of the people, 99%, were people inside there and were working. And, you know, some of our friends at the University of Berkeley came. They were brought in and provided great information for people. We had people, good scientists that came on board and were able to break down the science of this issue. But I think that sometimes we don't remember that a lot of people care about their food and they care about their environment. We just have to figure out how to reach them.
Right. You know, we're talking about food. I mean, that's just across the board for everybody. It doesn't matter what your deep race is or your socioeconomic status. It doesn't matter. We all have to eat, and we need to be conscious about what we're consuming.
Well, you know, one of the things that brought me to this movement was Cesar Chavez and his 36-day fast that he had in 1988 against pesticides and herbicides and what they were doing to farm workers. And there's a great video out on Caesar's Last Fast called Caesar's Last Fast that people should look at. It'll soon be available. Right now it's at the festivals. But if you Google Caesar's Last Fast, you'll see a good trailer for it. But I think, you know, just a quick story about myself. My family were farm workers. My mother worked in the fields until the day I was born and went back to work 2 days after I was born. So she had been sprayed consistently as a farm worker with pesticides and herbicides. And we know now that that affects the reproductivity of families and animals, and it also ends up in the mother's womb and ends up in the mother's milk. We had probably the most fertile families coming from Mexico, and now we have cases of sterility that we never had before. The only thing that I can say that could possibly have done it was pesticides. And we know that's happening in a lot of animals, and it's happening in other people. We can create history because we have people power. They only have money. They're interested in the profit. We're interested in surviving in our lives. They're fighting for the profits. We're fighting for our lives. And as long as we're fighting for our lives, we're not going to give up. And we're going to win.
That's right. That is right. Very well put. And I'm speaking with Magdalena Rose Avila, lifelong human rights activist, Chicano, grew up in Colorado, and has just made his way all over the world, founding director of the Cesar Chavez Foundation, and affiliate of Amnesty International, and founder of Homies Unidos, an organization that assists Salvadoran gang members transition to a better life. Thank you so much for being on A Rude Awakening. Let us know about your tour. You're going to be here in the Bay Area at the end of the month.
Well, I'm going to go through all of California. I'm starting at the Bay Area. I'm going to hope to meet with people in Chico, Sacramento, and the Bay Area. So people want to call you, Sabrina, there at the station and say, yeah, I'd like to meet this crazy Chicano who's fighting for human rights and food rights.
Amazing Chicano.
Time to come, you know. And then I'm going to go down to Delano and meet with people, farm workers that I work with, organizers there. In San Luis Obispo, I'm meeting with some organic farmers who are supporting some of the stuff that I'm doing. And then I'm going to go to L.A. and meet with hopefully some of my friends in film and music and see if I can get them on to our campaign. But the issue is that there are so many people who have done so much good work in California that all I'm doing is adding a little chili to this stew and making it a little hotter. But there's already been a lot of work done. One of the things I should tell people, in case there's somebody out there who says, you know, I have a skill, but I don't know how to use it. Every skill can be used. As we had talked earlier, it's the arts that will reach people.
That's right.
And we need the artists. We need the technicians. We need the dreamers.
All right. And what dates are you going to be out here in the Bay Area? It's June 23rd or 22nd?
Well, I'll be there. I'm starting out in Chico on the 25th, so I should be into the Bay Area the 26th or 27th.
All right.
And I'm also going to Santa Cruz to meet with people there, including Barrios Unidos and others. So anyone would like to get a hold of me, we can either have a phone conversation or face-to-face. But the importance is that we can do this together.
Most definitely. All right, Magdalena Rose Avila, if you want to get in touch with me, you can email me at sabrina@kpfa.org. That's sabrina@kpfa.org. I will do my best to keep you abreast of everything that's going on with Mr. Magdalena Rose Avila, his travels, and his fight, the latest fight that you can join, that we all need to join. Mr. Rose Avila, thank you so much for being on A Rude Awakening.
Thank you, Sabrina. And it is a rude awakening. Now that we're awake, let's do something.
And we're going to switch gears a little bit here. I have Natalie Reese. Ms. Reese is an organizer with WORD, Women Organize to Resist and Defend. And they have a local chapter here in the San Francisco Bay Area. Ms. Reese is on the line right now to talk about their latest action and to bring attention to the Marissa Alexander case in Florida. And Ms. Reese, thank you so much for being on A Rude Awakening.
Thank you for having me.
Now, let's start with what happened. Just give us a brief summary of what happened with Marissa Alexander, her partner, ex-partner, in Florida, and their altercation.
Right. So she actually just had a baby a number of weeks previous, and her ex-partner's name, Rico Gray, he has a history of abuse and violence towards women that's documented. And she had gone to the house to get stuff that was there in that house. He attacked her in front of his son, and she tried to escape through the garage and was unable to. She grabbed a weapon that is registered to her name that she owns and fired a warning shot to try to get him to stop so that she could get out the front door. And that warning shot hit the ceiling above the refrigerator where she was aiming. It was just a warning shot. No one was hurt. No one was injured. And she was then arrested and convicted of aggravated assault and was given 20 years in prison under mandatory gun sentencing laws. That trial was then overturned and she was freed. The instructions to the jury were incredibly ridiculous. You know, the first jury only deliberated for 12 minutes before finding her guilty. The entire thing was a setup. Mm-hmm. It was a racist, sexist setup. Mm-hmm. And the movement is really the factor that freed her the first time. Mm-hmm. The state prosecutor, Angela Corey, has it out for Marissa Alexander. And this is the same prosecutor that, you know, basically let George Zimmerman walk free.
Mm.
The prosecution in that case was a joke. Mm-hmm. He clearly murdered Trayvon Martin and should not have been free. The same prosecutor who allowed that to happen and really did allow it to happen. Of course, she's going after Marissa Alexander. What's happening now is Marissa is on house arrest, and Angela Corey keeps harassing her, trying to get her back in jail for trips that are approved trips that she has a right to go out and to do, and then she'll get back home and she'll get a notice telling her to appear in the court again. And so she's really being harassed. And what they're trying to do is give her 60 years in prison on the second trial. The trial had been scheduled for this coming July 28th, and it has actually been moved to December because Marissa's defense has tried to invoke the Stand Your Ground law, which is the same law people should remember George Zimmerman's attorneys tried to or used as well, and in that case successfully, even though he was in no danger. In the first trial, they didn't allow her to use the Stand Your Ground defense, but this July, there'll be a hearing on whether or not she'll be able to use the Stand Your Ground defense in the coming trial in December. So what's happening right now is that she is under house arrest, although she's out of prison. She's facing 60 years in trial, and we're really trying to build a nationwide movement to get Judge Daniels to totally dismiss the charges, just dismiss the charges right away, which he could do.
This prosecutor, Angela Corey, last name spelled C-O-R-E-Y, she currently is serving as the state attorney in Florida's 4th Judicial Circuit Court. That's Florida's 4th Judicial Circuit Court. She's a state attorney, which includes Duval, Nassau, and Clay counties, and as well as Jacksonville and the Corvitz metropolitan area. And the woman's name is Angela B. Corey. Just want to make sure our audience gets her name. Very important.
And actually, I don't know, if people go to our website at defendwomensrights.org, you can send a letter right now to Corey and to other officials demanding that they do dismiss the charges,
mm-hmm.
Which is, I think, a good action everyone should take if they could.
And, you know, here's a rude awakening for Angela Corey. She really needs to look at herself. You know, it's like how many people that have offended women that she's put away. It's like, how are the roles reversed all of a sudden? You know, and why is she taking it to the extent of, you know, instead of just letting it die, she's making an active effort. She's making a huge effort to try and get this woman, to harass this woman, to try and get her back in the court again. You know, where is that drive coming from? What is wrong with this woman? She really needs to get a clue because she's not making any points. You know what I'm saying?
What it shows is that it's not just one individual, and it's not even just one individual in Florida. It's the entire system,
That's
right. It's racist and it's sexist. And what it means is that, you know, one woman who acts as an attorney and has probably had to fight to get to that position, mm-hmm. a lot of pressure is put on her to be even more sexist and more racist if you don't really stand against her own interests mm-hmm. and the interests of all of us, because she's really a representative of a system. Mm-hmm. And that system is one that, you know, lets Trayvon Martin die in vain and let George Zimmerman walk free after murdering mm-hmm. this young African-American boy. It's the mm-hmm. same system that puts Marissa Alexander in jail when Rico Gray, who's the abusive one. I mean, that's the crime that was committed, was this man beating a woman. Mm-hmm. And he has never been in prison for that. But she defends herself, and she finds herself locked up, freed, and now threatened with even more years, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, the whole way that system is set up is unjust.
You know, I don't know. I mean, I don't know how this woman goes to bed at night, you know? Okay, yeah, you're a part of this system. You chose to become a part of this system. Be an agent of change. This is just, it's not okay on so many levels. And she needs to step out of that bubble of Florida that she's living in and that cushy lifestyle and get a taste of the real world. Because Marissa Alexander does not deserve to live like this. She does not deserve to be harassed. She needs to be set free. And that horrible partner of hers needs to go away, period.
Exactly. I mean, we totally agree. And it's a situation where men are just, you know, where men are committing violent acts against women, walking free over and over again, mm-hmm. and the women who defend themselves, mm-hmm. you know, they're fighting to save themselves, to survive and protect their children.
That's right.
And they're ending up in prison. And Marissa Alexander is, you know, it's an important case, and we're fighting for her freedom right now. Mm-hmm. But she's really representative of a whole lot more. That's because right. She's not the only woman who's defended herself and found herself facing charges for that.
That's right.
And it's right. You know, there's one of the fastest growing populations in prisons right now is women.
Mm-hmm.
And that's most right. of those women are going away for, first of all, nonviolent crimes completely associated with poverty.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, attempts to survive in pretty high impoverished situations. And also mm-hmm. for crimes that are not crimes at all. Like, defending yourself is not a crime and shouldn't be considered one.
Mm-hmm.
Yet, many women are in prison right now because of just that, because they, you know, defended themselves against an abusive partner, whether it was with a weapon or not.
Mm-hmm.
And they're the ones who get picked up.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just a completely ridiculous situation mm-hmm. that women should face in this country mm-hmm. today.
That's right.
Yeah.
It is definitely, definitely scary. Well, I am speaking with Natalie Reese. Yeah. Natalie Reese is an organizer with WORD, Women Organize to Resist and Defend. And she's on the line with me. We're discussing the Marissa Alexander case. There's a huge action that's coming up on the 20th and the 21st here in the San Francisco Bay Area. They're also going to be in Los Angeles. They'll be in New Haven, Connecticut, Washington, D.C., and New York City, New York. But here in the San Francisco Bay Area, it's going to be on Saturday, June 20th. The Speak Out is at 11 a.m., and that's at Powell and Market Streets. Powell and Market Streets. If you need more information, go to SF at defendwomensrights.org. That's defendwomensrights.org. And that's WORD, Women Organize to Resist and Defend. Natalie Reese, thank you so much for being on A Rude Awakening. Truly appreciate your time, honey.
Thank you, Sabrina, for having us.
Most definitely.
Just breathe.
On the line with me today on A Rude Awakening, I have Julio Escobar. Mr. Escobar is part of the Archdiocese of San Francisco, the Office of Public Policy and Social Concerns. He is the director of the Restorative Justice Program of the Catholic Church, and he is at Yanira Serrano's funeral today. Mr. Escobar, thank you so much for being on A Rude Awakening.
Yeah, thank you very much for your invitation.
Absolutely. Now, what happened, or we already know what happened with Ms. Yanira Serrano. There were some issues on her part as far as her mental health, but there was never been an issue as far as the authorities having to intervene. And all of a sudden, now she's dead. So why is Archdiocese concerned about what happened to Ms. Yanira Serrano? Why are you there today?
Our Restorative Justice Ministry looks and support for families that are involved in violent crimes and in San Mateo and San Francisco and Marin County. So whenever there's a homicide, we approach the family and we become basically present in their lives in terms of healing. And, you know, we have a growing number of families now that are part of our support that we provide to them. So when we heard about this, we were immediately here just to support the family and be involved. And basically, it's a long life commitment for us in the church and the archdiocese. At the same time, we also work with the offenders. So we visit those people that are in prisons and jails, mm-hmm. Including San Quentin. So our long-term goal is to, you know, look at the harm that has been caused and bring healing and peace among both, including the community. So in this case, we're here to support the family, and it's, you know, whenever there's a violent death, and in this case, it appears to be very unjust, you know, we still get involved with the family mm-hmm. and support them.
Mm-hmm. Now, Mr. Escobar, are you going to make an attempt to speak with the offending officer, the officer that shot her?
That would be the ultimate for us. However, that's usually what we try to do, to hear the side of the officer that got involved, and long term, hopefully, we would, you know, like to have a meeting with him and the family. But usually, with when it involves the officials, you know, they don't usually open up for this type of restorative justice opportunity, which it should be basically what should happen.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, it will be a long time before we can get a hold of him to, you know, come close to the family, and regardless how it happened.
Mm-hmm.
And so there is a restorative, you know, closure to this, for the family.
Right.
And for himself, and for himself.
Have you ever, in officer-involved shootings, have you, as a director, directed your portion of the Catholic Church, the Archdiocese of San Francisco, towards speaking with the officers? I mean, and have you ever been successful talking to officers that are, have been involved in civilian shootings?
No, it has been very difficult from the Sheriff Department to try to do that. However, you know, we have that recent situation with the Alex Nieto shooting in San Francisco,
right,
where four officers were involved in shooting Alex. And, you know, that's a somewhat similar case.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, because we have a better relationship with the San Francisco Sheriff Department, we, you know, we're going to be looking at that. But, you know, the case has not, is still going on, so we're going to have to wait for that.
Sir Julio Escobar, Archdiocese of San Francisco, Office of Public Policy and Social Concerns, Director of the Restorative Justice Program of the Catholic Church. He is on the line with me right now from Half Moon Bay at the funeral of the young lady that was shot and killed by San Mateo County Sheriff, Yanira Serrano. Yanira Serrano was only 18 years old. But she did have some mental health issues that were under control with medication. When her family had problems with her, they would call the authorities. Never had a problem before, but this time, instead of the paramedics, it was San Mateo County Sheriffs that came out and ended up shooting and killing this child. I mean, she was only 18 years old. So what is the scene there right now? What is the scene there, Mr. Escobar?
There's probably... let's see, I want to say probably about 50 to 75 people waiting for the funeral car to come with the body.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure this is going to get, you know, full packing. More people are coming. I think Channel 2 is here and all the media. And the mother is really, you know, in bad shape. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I've been talking to the father and to the brother. And again, we're here to support them in the absence of Yanira. But it's you know, because where it happened, there's not a history of violence in that little community.
Right.
Most people are you know farmer workers and labor workers, and the shooting was being a big thing. I mean, the whole community has been affected, and basically, you know, going through some intimidation because there is really some tension here, and this is a calm community. It's not a you know, a community where there is a gangs or anything in this particular neighborhood with, you know, Anita lived. So I think, yeah, you know, people need to really, you know, the officials really need to be extremely careful when they get calls about like this, to really analyze the neighborhood. And of course it's an emergency, but you know, you cannot just go and, you know, make assumptions, just kill people like that. So yeah, it's very difficult right now.
Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Well, I'm sure the family is very thankful that of your presence there, and I truly hope that there is a way that you're able to speak with the officer. You know, I hope that this is a different situation than the past situations you've encountered, being the director of the Restorative Justice Program for the Catholic Church. You know, and as far as officer-involved shootings are concerned, because that blue wall needs to come down, and there needs to be that conversation in order for the healing to happen. So
exactly.
Hopefully the state will start to see the need for that. And do truly appreciate your efforts, Mr. Escobar, and truly appreciate you talking to me and Rude Awakening.
It seems that the answers lie in the 911 call made by the family to public services for assistance with Yanira. Why did the situation escalate? How could this have been avoided?
And you are listening to 9-